All right, everybody. So good morning and welcome to lecture 24 of Quantum Mechanics 1. Now, I asked you this before off the record. I'll ask this again on the record. Do you have anything do you want to tell me about my course coverage, about the speed, about how good or bad my jokes are, or any of those possible topics? Okay, all right. Well, if you do, please say something. So in yesterday's class, we talked about, and if some of you can turn your videos on, I would be very grateful. Thank you. In yesterday's class, we talked about the fact that if you look at the harmonic, classical harmonic oscillator, it has in the phase space, the picture looks like this, right? The system traces out elliptical orbits, right? So each point on the phase space in one of these orbits, each point represents a configuration of the system at a particular time, right? So let's say this is T1, this is T2, this is T3, right? And so you would have T1 is less than, T2 is less than T3. So this represents any oscillatory motion, right? Something which is on a spring or a pendulum or something like that. Now, and each ellipse corresponds to a fixed energy, right? So unless you give some energy to the oscillator or you take some energy from the oscillator, the point in the phase space, it will remain the same. I mean, it will remain on the same orbit, right? Okay, now here the energy is given by this B square parameter, right? So, and B square can be any real number, right? So this B square belongs to, like, there's no restriction on it, right? So which implies that the energies, the possible energies, right? So this belongs to R plus, right? Because it's square of a real number. So that means the energy is also any real number, right? So you can imagine that you have a dial, right? And it has a label energy. And as you increase the dial, you can go from one energy to another energy to a third energy. And you can do so continuously. Okay. So what we will see is that it doesn't work like that in quantum mechanics. Okay. So today we'll be talking about the quantum harmonic oscillator, right? So this was the classical harmonic oscillator, and today we'll talk about the quantum harmonic oscillator. Okay. Okay. So what do we do? How do we write down? How do we go from the classical system to the quantum system, right? So we want to do something that is known as quantization, right? Which means that you start with a classical system, and then you write down its quantum, the expression for the quantum mechanical system, right? So you start with a classical Hamiltonian, and you write down the quantum Hamiltonian. So the classical Hamiltonian, what? It's a function of some x and p, right? So how do we quantize? So if we, you know, this quantization procedure involves taking your variables, your phase space variables, and replacing them with operators. Okay, in most cases this works. You just replace them. It doesn't work always, but in most cases. So if we just do that in this case, what do we get? We have h is equal to p squared by 2m plus 1/2 k squared, kx squared. And so this Hamiltonian will become p squared. What is p squared? Is the operator p squared, right? So I'll just write p squared by 2m plus 1/2 kx hat squared, right? That's it. We have quantized our harmonic oscillator, right? But what is the next step? The next step is to find out, this is a quantum system. So quantum systems have eigenvectors and eigenvalues, right? So this classical system, it can have any real energy. Any positive real energy. We can ask, can this Hamiltonian system have any real energy? Well, we have to look at the eigenvalue equation. What is the eigenvalue equation? Right, this is the eigenvalue equation. It's asking us that, right? We don't know what this state psi is. So this state psi, if it's an eigenstate, right, of H, eigenstate, eigenvector, one interchangeably, then if H acts on this, it will give me E times psi, right? And what is this expression, right? This expression is basically the time-independent Schrodinger equation, right? Because when I replace, so now instead of working with this, so this is psi, right? So once again, let me work with my position basis expression. This is in the position basis. So my coefficients are functions of right now. So what happens to these operators? Let's ask what happens to these operators, right? So if you have x hat acting on psi, right, what does it give you? It gives you psi of x hat acting on ket x dx. This expression here, this ket, this is an eigenstate of the position operator, right? Just give me 1 second, please. I'll be right back. So this is an eigenstate of the position operator, right? So this will just become psi of x times x t, right? This operator just pulls out the value of the number x from that eigenstate. Okay. Then what about the action of this position operator, right? So what is the position operator? Position operator is in the position basis. Sorry, the momentum operator in the position basis. What is it? Can anybody tell me real quickly? Drishika, what is the momentum operator in the position basis? Siddhant? कोई है भी वहां पे? सब सो रहे हो? हाँ, ऋषिका, हेडफोन्स आर नॉट वर्किंग. थैंक यू ऋषिका, दैट्स राइट. इट्स माइनस आई एच बार डी बाई डी एक्स ऑफ साई, राइट? हाउ डज दिस ऑपरेटर एक्ट ऑन माई स्टेट? यू विल गेट माइनस आई एच बार डी साई एक्स बाई डी एक्स, गेट एक्स डी एक्स. ठीक है. Now, and I realize that some of you, or maybe many of you, are feeling a little bit confused because I'm taking this x operator and I'm saying it acts on this ket, but I'm taking this momentum operator and saying it acts on this function. Okay, so there is a way to make this all very, very easy. I haven't done that, but it is all there in Sakurai. Maybe when we have our offline this thing clarification session, then I can explain these things to you better. So if you wish, you can think of this x operator as acting on psi of x. It has the same effect, right? So in our Hamiltonian, in this Hamiltonian, we have p square and we have x square, right? So p square is equal to minus h bar square by 2m. Sorry, p square by 2m is equal to minus h bar square by 2m d by dx square. Excuse me. And the other term, well, that's just 1/2 kx square. So our Hamiltonian becomes, so our Hamiltonian acting on psi, right? What I can do is I can take the, so I can write it like this, right? Hamiltonian acting on psi of x ket x dx, right? And instead of let me take this as x prime get x prime dx prime. Now on the left hand side I'll put an eigenbra of x. Okay, so what will be the result? The result will be the following. You'll get x h hat psi x prime x prime d. Okay. Now I don't need to do all of that. I mean, I can just skip ahead to the statement that h acting on psi of x is equal to minus h bar square by 2m d square by dx square psi of x plus 1/2 kx squared. Now when the operator x square acts on psi of x, you will just get the position psi of x, and this is equal to e psi of x, right? So this is our eigenvalue equation. And this eigenvalue equation is a differential equation, right? By now you must have gotten the general idea that the Schrodinger equation is a differential equation, right? So, and differential equations are, in general, you can write them as eigenvalue equations. Not all of them, but at least linear differential equations can be written as eigenvalue equations. So we have to solve this expression, right? If we solve this expression, we will get our solutions for psi of x, right? And that will give us our eigenstates and eigen energies. Okay. Now, how do we solve this, right? Because if I didn't have this term over here, if I didn't have this kx squared, then I know my answer. My answer is easy. What is my answer? My answer is just the oscillating function, right? But now, what do I have? I have a potential term. So I can write psi of x like this, right? Psi of x is equal to 2m by h bar square e minus v of x, right? So I put a double prime over here. Double prime means second derivative, right? This is psi of x. So I can write this as d of psi prime x by dx. Right, the second derivative of psi is the equal to the derivative of the first derivative, right? So I can, and since we are taking psi to depend only on the position, I'll just write that as a total derivative rather than a partial derivative. Right, now let me write psi prime x as some function f of x. So I have, so okay, do I have a differential equation in psi prime? No, I don't, right? Okay, so this doesn't, this is not so helpful. What can I do? Well, one way to solve most any differential equations, it's called the series solution, okay? So if you don't know how to solve an equation, a differential equation or any other kind of equation, what should one do, right? Well, you make the guess. So if you have some function, a function can have some Taylor series expansion, right? So we make the guess that, well, maybe we can expand our function in some powers of x. Okay, it's called the power series expansion. Here k will be something from minus infinity to infinity, right? So you will have x over 1 by x squared, and also x and x squared and all that. You'll have all those terms in this expression, right? Then the next step is to take this power series solution and substitute it into your differential equation, right? So when you substitute into differential equation, what happens? What will happen? Here you have the second derivative, right? So the second derivative, when it acts on this power series, what will it do? When it acts on each term in this power series, it will take that term and reduce the power of the exponent by 2, right? What about this other term? The second term involves a multiplication by x squared, right? So you have 1 by kx squared. I'll just write it as x squared. This multiplied by each term in the series will give me x times k plus 2, right? And this last term, well, this will just give me, this will not change the exponent, right? So what I will have is some constant times x to the k minus 2 plus some constant x to the k plus 2 is equal to, again, some some constant. Some constant times CK, that CK also will not matter. So K minus 2 plus some constant times x to the K plus 2 is equal to some constant times x to the K. Right? And this has to be true for all K. So you have a set of infinite such equations, right? Because this power series is also an infinite expression. So this gives you a set of recursive expressions, right? So for example,
excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Is those two k's are same?
Huh?
The potential term k and the expansion k.
This one.
This k and the potential energy term k, half kx squared k.
No. Please. Thank you for pointing that out.
Okay.
This is an integer, right? This is not the k of kx squared. So maybe I should have used a different variable. Thanks for asking that. So a recursive set of equation is what? It's something which looks like this, right? You have some function of, let's say, xn. And let's say xn plus 1. And this is equal to some function, let's say, of g of xn minus 1, right? So why do we call this a recursive series, right? Because, so if you look at the next term, let's say we'll get xn plus 1 xn plus 2 is equal to g of xn minus, sorry, n, right? So it's called a recursive series because if you can solve this equation, you can substitute that in here. You can solve this equation, you can substitute that in the next term, and so on, right? So you will get a nested solution. That's why it's called a recursive. That is known as recursion. Okay. So if you can solve this equation for a particular value of k, right, then you can substitute that into the next level, and in this way you can, the hope is that you can solve, you can get some sort of recursive expression for the coefficients. Right, because what we want is we want to solve for the coefficients. So there will be some. Actually, it's an equation in terms of the coefficients, not in terms of the. Right, should be a little bit more careful about that. Because what we want is, we want to determine this psi, and to determine the state psi, we need the coefficient Ck, right? Oh, what am I doing? C. So if you can solve this kind of an equation for these coefficients, right, then that will give us a solution. Okay, so that is one way to solve this differential equation. But there is a very, very, very clever way that is due to Dirac. Okay, And this, the Dirac solution is very, very, which is mind-blowing, okay? Because it doesn't involve you to use any derivatives or anything like that. It is a purely algebraic solution. What do you mean by algebraic solution? Means that we work at the level of operators. And we will see that we will get a bunch of equations that can all be solved very, very simply and very straightforwardly. Let's see how this works. Right? If you understand it, if you see how it works, then you'll understand it. So how does the Dirac method work? Well, we look again at this Hamiltonian. Okay. And now Dirac had the following idea that this expression, let me write it as capital P. Okay. And the second expression, I'll write it as capital X. Okay. Dirac's observation was the following. Well, if you have an expression of this form, it can be factored in this way, right? Because remember that a squared minus b squared is what? A plus b times a minus b, right? So if you write a plus b squared, you can factor that as a plus ib, a minus ib, right? That's what is being done over here. Okay. And what Dirac said was, well, I will call the, so this is some linear combination of two operators, right? This is the another linear combination of the same two operators. So let me call the first operator A and let me call the second operator B. Okay. So A is equal to P plus IX. B is equal to P minus IX. All right. Then Dirac said, okay, let me ask, what is the commutation relationship between A and B? Right? Because remember, what is the commutation relationship between X and P? What is this? This is IH bar, right? If you haven't worked this out, this is a homework exercise. Okay. So one can ask, what is the commutation relation of A and B? Right. So well, let's try to work that out. We put P plus IX hat, P minus IX hat, right? We want to ask what is this commutator? So what will you get? You will get, when you expand out all the terms, what will you get? You will get the commutator of P with P, the commutator of P with X, X with P, and then the commutator of X with X, right? This is zero and this is zero, right? Why is it, why are these zero? Because, you know, you're taking the commutator of the same operator with itself, so it's obviously going to be zero, right? And what are we left with? We are left with these two expressions here, So let's take this. This is xp, right? It will be something proportional to ih bar. So it will be I, then this will get, you will get some constant c times ih bar, right? And this expression is just the negative of, here you have a negative sign, but you can take that negative sign and you can switch the order of the commutator. So you get exactly the same expression, right? You get something like this. You get I, C, I. Which is equal to something like minus 2 C H bar. Right? So the commutator of A and B is equal to some constant, right? This is some constant number. That's the most important part. Okay. And then what happens to your Hamiltonian? Our Hamiltonian is written in terms of P and X, right? Can I write this Hamiltonian in terms of these operators A and B? Well, I can take this expression and I can invert it, right? I can write P is equal to A plus B, right? I can just take these two equations and add them both sides. I'll get P is equal to A plus B by 2. And X is equal to A minus B by 2i, right? So what is my Hamiltonian become now? My Hamiltonian becomes P squared plus X squared, right? So I just take the square of these objects. What do I get? I get 1 by 4. P squared will give me A square plus B square plus AB plus BA, right? I have to be careful because when I take this square over here, I can't just write down 2AB because A and B, they don't commute with each other, right? So I have to write down AB plus BA. What about the second term, X hat square? I get minus, because of this factor of I, right? I get a minus 1. Times 1 by 4, A square plus B square, right, minus AB minus BA. Okay? Now what will happen? These terms, the terms that are quadratic in A and B, they will cancel out, right? Because of this negative sign. So what will my Hamiltonian look like? Well, it will look like this. I'll get 1 by 2 AB plus BA. Okay. Now, the commutator of A and B is some constant. I'll just call that something else. I'll call it C prime, this whole thing. The commutator of A and B is some constant, which is C prime. So that means AB minus BA is equal to C prime, right? Which means I can write AB is equal to this constant plus BA. Okay, now I substitute this expression back into my Hamiltonian. What do I get? I substitute this expression for AB over here, right? So I get 1/2 C prime plus 2 times BA. Right? So this becomes BA plus C prime by 2. This is a constant, and this is the product of those two operators, B and A. Okay, at this point, you might think, well, you have not achieved any simplification of the problem, but you have. Why is that the case? The reason for that is the following. You can show that these operators, they have a very nice action on the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian. Okay. So it turns out that if I can write down the eigenstates of my Hamiltonian, let me write them as some ket n, okay, where n is some parameter. It's some real number. For example, n could represent the momentum. Okay. But it turns out that if I take this b, right? Okay. And so since this is an eigenstate, that means that if I act on this eigenstate with h, what do I get? I get en, the eigenvalue times n, right? And we can show that this operator B acting on n gives me the eigenstate which has an eigenvalue which is one number higher. A acting on the n state gives me the eigenstate which is one number lower. Right? So what is going on here? If you imagine that you have, these are your eigenvalues. Okay. This is E of n, right? Energy is increasing from top to bottom, bottom to top. What does the action of the B operator do? The B operator takes you from lower eigenstates to higher eigenstates. It increases the energy of your system. The A operator takes you from to lower eigenstates. It decreases the energy of your system. Okay. Increases your energy, and then this decreases energy. Right? So in the picture that we had earlier of this, of these orbits, right? What the B operator is doing is, the B operator is taking you from one orbit to another orbit, but towards the increasing energy scale. And the A operator is taking you in the other direction. Okay. Now, once you have this, you have basically solved the problem. Why? Because what you find is, so let me write down the expression. Now I'll write it down properly. Okay, am I audible? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So if I work everything out very carefully, I get the following expression for my Hamiltonian. Okay, so you see over here I had given you an expression of this form, right? So that's what I get over here. Okay, so I can take this factor of C prime. I've taken that common. If I take that common, I pull it outside, it becomes equal to h bar omega. What is omega? Omega is equal to k by root of k by m. Right? Remember that k and m are the spring constant and the mass, right, of the oscillator. And these are my two operators, a dagger and a. This is called a creation operator. And I have a. This is called the annihilation operator. Okay, why do we call them, why do we give them such fancy names, creation and annihilation? Right, because what does A dagger do? Right, what does this B hat do? B hat increases the energy of the system, right? Because it increases the value of N by 1. So if it increases the value of n by 1, that means En goes to En plus 1. Right? So it is creating one quantum of energy and supplying that to your oscillator. This is destroying one quantum of energy and taking it from your oscillator. Right, so this is called, that's why they are given these names. They are also known as the raising and lowering operators. Right, why? Because if you imagine that you have a ladder, this is a ladder. This is a ladder of your energies, right? Then A dagger takes you up the ladder and A takes you down the ladder, right? So you go to, you raise your energy with A dagger and lower it with A. And then you have this combination of the two operators, A dagger and A. This is called the number operator. Okay. Why is it called the number operator? Right? It's this BA, right? It's called the number operator because if you take A dagger A and act on my eigenstate of the Hamiltonian, I get this parameter n times n, right? And then we will see later that n is actually a positive integer, or it's a non-negative integer. So it can be 0, 1, 2, and so on. I'll just write it. Right? And your states are labeled by n. The total energy of any one state is h bar omega times n plus 1/2. So what are your energies? You have E0. E0 is equal to h bar omega by 2. E1, right? Is 1 plus 1/2, that's 3/2, each time you increase by h bar omega. E2 is equal to 5/2 h bar omega, and so on. Right? So each time you go up one step of this ladder, you increase your energy by h bar omega. Each time you go down, you decrease the energy by h bar omega. This corresponds to your ground state. This is your lowest energy state, right? And these are your excited states. Okay. And what does this operator do when it acts on one of these eigenstates? It gives you this number n. So you can think of n as a number of quanta of energy in a state, right? So the lowest state, the ground state, you can say it doesn't have any quanta, but you know, it has some energy h bar omega by 2, but we call that the vacuum energy or the zero point energy. Okay. E1 has one quantum, E2 has two quantum, and so quanta and so on. So this is just giving you the number of quanta in your energy eigenstate. And your energy eigenstates, what should they correspond to? They should correspond to these orbits, right? In the classical phase space, that's what you have. A fixed energy corresponds to an orbit, right? So that's how you can think of this A dagger and A. They're taking you from one orbit to another orbit. But there is an interesting aspect, which is the following. In the classical case, your energy the energy of your oscillator, it can be as small as possible. Okay, again disconnected, I think. Okay. So in the classical case, your energy can be as small as possible, right? So you can take your ellipse and you can shrink it down. Right? You can keep shrinking it down until you get to zero energy. Until you get to zero energy, you can keep shrinking it down. But in the quantum case, what do you find? You find that in the quantum case, you cannot shrink your lowest energy. So your lowest energy is given by h bar omega by 2, right? So let me label this as E naught. This is E1 and this is E2. So once I'm down here, I cannot shrink this orbit anymore. Okay. And this is actually an expression of the uncertainty principle. I'll let you think about why it is an expression of the uncertainty principle. I'll stop here for today. And then tomorrow we'll work out the this Dirac solution systematically. Okay. So of course it would help if you went and did some reading, but yeah. All right, so I'll stop the recording here.